Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed.
Hallelujah. Welcome to the house of the Lord. This is the day the Lord has made. So let us rejoice and be glad in it. It is a great opportunity for us to continue worshiping in this Easter season. So we continue with the traditional Easter greeting. We're going to carry that through for a little while yet. And it strikes me that maybe there should be another reading of some kind that kind of carries us through the rest of the year. So what comes after the Easter season in the church year? Does anybody know? Pentecost. So we've got Pentecost 50 days after Easter. So that'll be on, I think, the first Sunday of June this year, if I've got my dates correct. And so maybe I think it'd be fun if some of you came up with some ideas for how we could greet one another, like during the season of Pentecost. Like not a traditional greeting. You know, we've got the psalm that welcome to the house of the Lord, that sort of thing. That's all good. And then there's Christ is risen. That's good too. There's lots of good things. But maybe there's like a spirit greeting that we could have during the season of Pentecost. What do you think? You want to go for that? All right, nope, okay, you say sure, but that doesn't mean you want to come up with the ideas. If you've got some ideas, just lay them on me. We'll come up with something fun that that we can learn and share throughout the Easter season, the Pentecost season. So you've got a couple weeks to figure that out. Just a reminder that we have prayer request forms at the back. They were found, so we've got a stack of them again on the usher stand. So those are available. We'll receive your prayer requests to include during the service, during our prayer time this morning, as we do. It is also Mother's Day, and so we recognize the mothers that are celebrating today. I think some of you, I don't know if there's extended family, some of you maybe brought your kids or something along the lines today. So that's very good. We remember and honor you this morning. We'll talk about the Mother's Day rose sale during the announcements at the end of the service this morning. So at this time, I invite you to rise and greet one another with a handshake or a wave or a smile of friendship.
Thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray. Father God, we come before you this morning, thanking you and praising you for all that you are and all that you call us to be. As you hear our voices this morning, let it not be us being consumed with the sound of our own voice, but with hearing you and your word. Speak to us this morning in Jesus' name. Amen. The congregation may be seated, and we'll continue with singing our psalmody, Psalm 23. Shelter us and restore our souls, and in you we find life everlasting. We come humbly into your presence this day in praise, worship, and adoration. Our hearts run over with your unfailing goodness and never-ending love. In the name of our Savior, we pray.
Our first reading is found in the book of Revelation, chapter 7, beginning at verse 9. The Apostle John is speaking. After this, I looked, and behold, a great multitude that no one could number, from every nation, from all tribes and peoples and languages, standing before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed in white robes, with palm branches in their hands, and crying out with a loud voice, "Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and to the Lamb." And all the angels were standing around the throne and around the elders and the four living creatures. And they fell on their faces before the throne and worshiped God, saying, "Amen, blessing and glory and wisdom and thanksgiving and honor and power and might be to our God forever and ever. Amen." Then one of the elders addressed me, saying, "Who are these clothed in white robes, and from where have they come?" I said to him, "Sir, you know." And he said to me, "These are the ones coming out of the great tribulation. They have washed their robes and made them white in the blood of the Lamb. Therefore, they are before the throne of God and serve him day and night in his temple. And he who sits on the throne will shelter them with his presence. They shall hunger no more, neither thirst any more. The sun shall not strike them, nor any scorching heat. For the Lamb in the midst of the throne will be their shepherd. And he will guide them to springs of living water. And God will wipe away every tear from their eyes." Our second reading is found from the Gospel of John, chapter 10, beginning at verse 22. At that time, the feast of dedication took place at Jerusalem. It was winter, and Jesus was walking in the temple in the colonnade of Solomon. So the Jews gathered around him and said to him, "How long will you keep us in suspense? If you are the Christ, tell us plainly." Jesus answered them, "I told you, and you do not believe. The works that I do in my Father's name bear witness about me, but you do not believe because you are not among my sheep. My sheep hear my voice, and I know them, and they follow me. I give them eternal life, and they will never perish, and no one will snatch them out of my hand. My Father, who has given them to me, is greater than all, and no one is able to snatch them out of the Father's hand. I and the Father are one." Pastor wanted me to read the bonus gospel of John, chapter 21, verses 15 to 17. When they had finished breakfast, Jesus said to Simon Peter, "Simon, son of John, do you love me more than these?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." He said to him, "Feed my lambs." He said to him a second time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" He said to him, "Yes, Lord, you know that I love you." He said to him, "Tend my sheep." He said to him the third time, "Simon, son of John, do you love me?" Peter was grieved because he said to him the third time, "Do you love me?" And he said to him, "Lord, you know everything. You know that I love you." Jesus said to him, "Feed my sheep." Thus far our readings.
Dear people of God, during our, opening announcements for our service today, I mentioned that it is Mother's Day. That is absolutely true. But it is also a Sunday of the church year that doesn't get a lot of, notoriety necessarily. It's called Good Shepherd Sunday. So you may have noticed all the shepherdy kind of hymns and talk that we've had going on so far. This worked really well at my last church. It's called Good Shepherd Lutheran. So that was a great day for that. But we got Prince of Peace. And it's not that there's no days to celebrate Prince of Peace, because we sing about that at Christmas time. So maybe that's the higher holiday, perhaps. But here we are with some of the shepherd talk, but paired up with some of the vision of St. John that he had of the eternal realm. And we're entitling this message, The Day Death Dies, which also connects with the opening hymn that we had, Crown Him with Many Crowns. If you look back through that, you'll see that phrase included in the text for that hymn. As some of you know, I worked as a custodian in my home congregation. And I call it my home congregation. There's some controversy about how pastors refer to the church that they grew up in. That's what I call my home congregation. That's where I spent most of my years, and certainly my formative years, at Our Savior's Lutheran Church in St. Paul, Minnesota. In some ways, I thought about that time of being the custodian as where I learned what goes on behind the scenes at churches, what things were necessary or helpful for a church to conduct worship and other ministries. I kind of had to figure things out, make sure that things were ready, set up, and clean for everything else to happen. For many of us, there's no such thing as just showing up for any activity, much less for this very special hour that we share together on Sunday mornings, because we need the grunt work done too. So that part of the job sticks in my brain as something I don't want to forget. And actually, I spent a number of years at that job before going on to the seminary, where I worked for another church as a custodian, because of course I had all this experience, so that was super easy to jump into that. And then on Vicarage, Michelle and I both worked as custodians for a time. Did we get paid for that? At Emmanuel and Parker's Prayer. That way. Not that way, that way.
I
don't know. We did the work. Whatever it was. So we've got some skills in terms of understanding what was going on as a custodian, what things were necessary to get into that. And so not only do I not want to forget, but it's kind of difficult to forget when you spend a few years with a particular job. But there's another aspect of the job, or the opportunities that I had while on the job there, that I still get to do because I'm here in this building today at hours when other people are not here, either before people arrive or well after people have left. As a late teen, when I was at my home congregation and working as a custodian there, I would go into the sanctuary when nobody else was around and just sing. And it didn't matter really to me what I sounded like, although I thought I sounded good. So I mean, maybe it did matter a little bit. But when I would walk into the sanctuary later at night, again after hours, after the meetings are closed down for the evening, I would go into the sanctuary and there was a single light in the darkness, which was the eternal light. A candle that reminds us that God was, that God is, and that God is to come, because He Himself is eternal. In our sanctuary, we have an eternal light. The churches that I have served prior to, I guess there were two that had candles. This one's electric, and if you look really closely, it's kind of an interesting configuration. But it's supposed to be symbolic. Candles are not more pure because, of course, they can get blown out. The idea is that one candle, when it's time to replace it, that you would light the other candle from the candle that was lit so that there's just one continuous flame. Again, to symbolize the eternal nature of God. The electric candle is on all the time, unless the power goes out. So again, it's symbolic. But when we enter into the sanctuary, that was the single light that illuminated the rest of the place. And so one little candlelight actually does light up quite a bit. Here we've got some other lights, we've got candles lit, we've got the cross back lit from time to time. But I would enter that space and my heart and my attitude, whatever I brought to it would almost instantly change. As I would sing, my voice echoed off what we had in the sanctuary. It was tile floor and brick walls. And in those moments, I imagined the vastness of heaven, with God seated on his throne, regaled by the angels, sometimes in unison, sometimes in harmony, but all the time in perfect praise, all the same. There was another way that the sanctuary holds memories for me. I wouldn't go in there just to sing, but also to cry. And not just cry. I don't know if there's different levels of what you might cry about. There's shedding a simple tear. You're overwhelmed by the smell of onion or something along those lines. And that's one way of crying. And then there's the gut-wrenching, sobbing, uncontrollable, ugly crying that you just let out once in a while. And you let it out because it's impossible to keep it inside. So I would go in there to cry, and again, not just cry, but bawl my eyes out completely. And it was about things that were really important to me as a 19 and 20-year-old. Broken relationships, uncertainty about my future, and sometimes just wishing I wasn't such a dummy with the decisions I made in those relationships or in preparing for the future. There's lots of things in between, but there are plenty of reasons to let it out. Now, looking back, I want to say that the pain of broken relationships at that age was not significant, but it totally was. And I have to say that I hated many of those days. But even in the midst of all that, I knew where to turn. I knew where to go. I knew where I could find relief and release for whatever was going on in my head and in my heart. For me, it was that otherwise empty church building, that sanctuary. But in general, that place is wherever you can hear the voice of God speaking to you. So for many of you, it might be this sanctuary where you wish you could come in at random off hours. While we were at the seminary, I met a young man named Kobe, and while that time was a little bit weird, because he demanded a lot of my time, he also asked some interesting questions. I showed him the chapel at the seminary campus in St. Louis, and I was going to take him at one point, and the doors were locked, and he was like, "Why do you lock your doors?" He was a Jewish fellow. And he's like, our what do you call them? Synagogues? Synagogues, they're never locked. Why? Why are your churches locked? Can't people just come in and worship God or be with him or whatever it is at all times? It's kind of an interesting thought that I keep that with me as well. So some people make the sanctuary or some place in a church building that holy place where they can go in and be themselves and cry if necessary or just release. Maybe it's a place in your home or someplace out in the woods someplace or maybe your car. Maybe it can be any of those places because, as we have discussed, God is not located in the sanctuary, but he attends. He is present here because his people are here. So to go where you can hear the voice of God speaking to you is important. And in those moments, as I recall, I could hear my own voice echoing, imagined it as the sounds of heavenly praise. I love you, Lord, and I lift my voice. But even as I lifted my voice, it was like I was also hearing the voice of God inviting me to proclaim and rejoice in the relationship that I had with Him. The relationship that I had with Him as my God, my King, my Shepherd. And so as I look back and I'm trying to theologize what I was doing in those moments and what I really liked about it or loved and what I remember, yeah, my voice was part of it. But I also think about it now that if my voice or if your voice is ever getting in the way of hearing God's word, God's voice, you need to shut your own mouth and make room to listen. Jesus says in John chapter 10, my sheep hear my voice, and I give them eternal life. And it's in that one statement that Jesus describes the fullness of his work. When Jesus is doing earthly work, he comes to us as the good shepherd, the one who cares, guides, protects, and leads. And when Jesus is doing heavenly work, he becomes the lamb, the one who sacrifices his own life that we might have eternal life. When we think of eternal life, we often think of a time or a life that isn't here quite yet. But really, for those who do hear the shepherd's voice, eternal life starts right now. We have God's promise that he is with us and that we are with him, which is true right now and will remain true forever. And when the scriptures talk about life and what kind of life God wants for us, he wants us to have eternal, abundant life. And he knows how we get there. We get to that eternal life through Jesus Christ. We have that life because of our relationship with him. That is what truly living is, a relationship with our Lord and Savior. But just like Jesus did earthly and heavenly work, we too have earthly and heavenly relationships. We will never be separated from the God who calls us and loves us. That much is true. What we don't have is an eternal relationship with the rest of creation, not right now. The text from Revelation is about the day when our earthly days are undone. We will no longer experience things as we do now. Right now, death is a part of everything. The food that we eat is either a dead plant or a dead animal. The death of relationships, the death of an era, the death of a program, and the death of people, the death of loved ones. We are plagued by so many of those things, and that's what our earthly life sees. But a good understanding of God's word helps us look death in the eye and say, you do not have the final word. In the day of the Lord, death is undone. It is the day death dies. It is the day that death and everything associated with it goes away. No hunger, no thirst, no scorching heat. God will provide what we need, and we will never be lacking for anything. There was a time that I thought this meant that we wouldn't need to eat or drink in the afterlife in heaven. But it's more about our trust in God being fully realized, that we will never be in want. It's Psalm 23, but without the lingering doubt of behind the words, wondering if God actually will provide and lead, as we say in the psalm. And when the text says that our tears will be wiped away, I used to think that it meant actually not crying at all, and that there would come a day when I wouldn't need to find that place to shed my tears and cry from my heart. But that day is really about realizing the full and tender mercy and care that God provides, and realizing it without lingering doubt there either. The day death dies, the doubts go with it. When we think that God is so far off, he will be, oh, so very near. Earthly things and the way that we think about them and our limited capacity and imperfection, the earthly things will be undone. The losses that we experience, the deaths that occur in our circles, we now feel will be comforted completely. Death and separation from others will be no more. In fact, we look forward to the day when we will be united with Christ in the marriage feast of the Lamb, and we begin an eternity of celebrating life. It is the day death dies. It is the day that we will rise, just as Christ was risen from the dead. May our singing, our crying, our praying, and our praising be lifted up to God as a reminder that we, body and soul, will be lifted up likewise, raised to new life and eternal relationships with others who hear and heed the voice of the Good Shepherd. In the name of the Spirit of Jesus, amen. We profess our faith through the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. In our prayers this morning, we'll remember and pray for Sue, who has started chemotherapy this week. Or she will start chemotherapy this coming. Heavenly Father, in your holy name, your Son purchased us with his own blood, and he now leads us through the gate of death to our eternal home with you. As we are the sheep of his fold, inspire us to hear his voice gladly and to follow him steadfastly through every tribulation in this earthly life. Lord, in your mercy. Our Lord, you have provided us with the gift of family. Lord, in this life, families look different. There's no family that looks the same as another. But today we especially pray that you would bless those who have shown us a mother's love and nurtured our lives from childhood. Bless and protect all mothers with child, all those who have suffered miscarriage or the death of a child, and all those who have yearned for a child and lived with the pain of this unfulfilled longing. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Compassionate Lord, you will not allow any power or enemy to triumph over your saving purpose or to take your lands from your hand. Give us wise and faithful leaders who will govern in our land according to your law and defend the lives of the unborn, the orphan, the widow, and the aged. Bless all those who make, administer, and judge our laws, that they may not hinder your purposes. Lord, in your mercy. Gracious God, you have not forgotten us in our afflictions or abandoned us in our weakness. Deliver the sick and suffering according to your will, and give your comfort to the dying, and especially to those who have requested our prayers, including Sue. Lord, you understand exactly what Sue is enduring this week as she is expecting to start chemotherapy and the uncertainty that goes along with it. But Lord, her times are in your hands. We pray that you would guard us against despair and grant us patience in the days of our own troubles as we await your perfect healing. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Lord, enthroned in heaven, you gather your saints into the shelter of your presence, making them white in the blood of the Lamb. Keep us faithful throughout our lives here and bring us through death to join them in the ceaseless praises of heaven. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive now the blessing of our Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. We have a few closing, actually, praise team, just sit tight for a second. Well, you can do whatever you want, okay? I'm not gonna stop you, but. So we've got a couple of announcements, and I'm gonna have Luis Beltran come up and speak for a couple of moments about, it's an opportunity, it's a ministry opportunity that takes place in the Forestville area, working with the Hispanic population there. So, just a couple of announcements before he speaks. So first of all, the Mother's Day Rose Sale, this is sponsored by Wisconsin Right to Life. I think it's the Door County chapter in particular, I should have said. So after the service, you're welcome to go out and explore that. I think Peggy Weston will be at the table. You'll have an opportunity to buy those roses. And I'm pretty sure that it's a suggested donation of $2 per stem, but they're willing to receive whatever you would want to donate toward that cause. So as we have been doing after the service, we'll allow a few minutes to go by, then I invite you to come right back into the sanctuary for some Q&A with me, and we'll go until 11 o'clock this morning. Last week we went longer, but if there's ever a time where it goes past the time that you can stay, you can feel free to just get up and go. It's not a sit down and, it is sit down, you don't have to stand around, but you just can leave at any point that you wish if you've got other things going on. Tap Brothers is tomorrow evening at 7 o'clock at the Carl Rausch Fire Pit, so you can join us for that. And Randy Waterholen is not here this morning, but he wanted me to mention that he is looking to do some mulching around the church grounds on Saturday, May 21st. So we're looking for volunteers to help out with that. You can call Randy directly or contact the church office, and we can pass your name along to Randy for him to get in touch with you. So, Luis, come on up. I'm going to share a couple of minutes here with you.
Thank you. Good morning. I'll be brief as brief as I can.
More brief? Okay.
Last year, toward the end, part of last year, Pastor Chris from our sister church in Forestville, he also has a second church in Rankin, just a little bit south of that. He wanted to start some Hispanic ministry of some kind. So he asked Pastor, because he's got a last name of Gomez, can you help with that? He said, no, but I got a guy. So it turns out that I was the guy. And since December, we have been started a little bit of ministry there. Bilingual services, Christmas, and Good Friday, and a couple other ones. different manner as I have done them in the past. Worked really well. Any questions about that, you can talk to me anytime. We also have been doing an English as a second language class for the folks. Most of them are newcomers to the area, but also to the country altogether, from different places. North is Mexico, is still North America. North America is Central America mostly. And there's a number of them. It's really neat to see a group of Hispanic people sit in the back, and everyone gets to see them. There's no missing a group of outsiders, if you will. If there was any group from a different church here in the corner somewhere, we would notice them, so everyone is aware of what's happening there too. There's a couple of things, or just one thing in particular. Pastor got a little a message from Pastor Chris. On Mondays, when we have our bilingual, our ESL class, we actually are providing a meal for them, whether it's a burger or a brat or something like that, something to go with it, because their work days are really long, and actually a couple of them don't even get a day off because farm work doesn't take a break. And there isn't enough workers in a couple of spots, so there's a number of them that don't even have a day off. And that's a really long day, so it's really, really hard. But he would like to extend an invitation for us also to help with the ministry if we wanted to. There's that time on Monday at about 7 to get started. They start coming 7:15. They come, we grab a little bite, a little drink. We get going at 7:30 to 8. And then we have a little bit of catechism thrown in there to make sure we can incorporate them to not just the church, but to the family and the class, to the surroundings that they can also integrate to where they are. So I'm going real long here. But it's a couple other ways to help as well. Please talk to me if you have a heart of serving. If you think, oh, I got an idea, talk to me too. There's actually a couple ways that we can have opportunities to help with that as well. Anything else?
That was perfect.
Well, that was good, Luis.
What?
That was good, Luis.
Well, you already mentioned a couple of things that I was going to take on again, so that one, my microphone is dead, so not that it matters too much, but.
So you already mentioned the meal times on a couple of Mondays. Those specific dates are Monday, May 16th, and May 23rd. So Pastor Chris Jackson is looking for people to provide a meal for those two times. There's about 15 people that attend is what he said, so maybe somewhere in there. So if you're interested in that, you can talk to Luis or you can talk to me, and we'll figure out a team and what we can make happen for that time. Thank you very much for sharing, Brother Luis. All right, the congregation can rise now, please, and we'll lift our voices as well to sing our closing song, King of Love.
Bye. than the